Since the fires in Northern California began, on a dry and windy night 2 weekends ago, they have charred nearly a quarter of a million acres of land, destroyed an estimated 5,700 structures, and killed more than 40 people. Most of the immediate damage has been limited to wine country, especially Napa and Sonoma counties, but the effects of the fires have been felt all over. Last week, the smoke and ash blew south, spreading over much of the San Francisco Bay Area, and stubbornly remaining there. Some school districts in the region have canceled classes, declaring the air too dangerous to breathe. At sunset, the sun has often glowed pink through the heavy, choking haze. This is truly one of the greatest, if not the greatest, tragedies California has ever faced, Governor Jerry Brown said on Saturday. The devastation is just unbelievable. It's a horror that no one could have imagined. The view from the author's home, near San Francisco, on a recent evening. Photograph courtesy Jeremy Miller. Today, a dozen large fires are still burning. According to the California Department of Forestry and Fire Protection's latest summary, the Atlas Fire, near Napa, is 77% contained, and the Nuns Fire, east of Sonoma, is 68% contained. Like the Oakland firestorm of 1991, which was previously considered the most destructive in California's history, the current conflagration has been abetted by an unusual weather pattern. The Bay Area's typical conditions, iconically foggy and cool, are the product of moisture-laden air blowing in from the Pacific. The so-called onshore wind carries humidity inland, keeping vegetation damp and suppressing the risk of fire, even in Napa and Sonoma, where temperatures are often 20, or even 30, degrees warmer than on San Francisco's waterfront. But when the wind switches direction, surging from the east, over the arid expanses of the Great Basin, conditions change rapidly. Humidity plummets, vegetation dries. Fire risk soars. Driven by gusting offshore winds, flames can spread rapidly and unpredictably. Preliminary findings suggest that blown transformers and fallen power lines may have started some of this month's blazes, though virtually any ignition source, a lightning strike, an errant cigarette butt, even a spark from the undercarriage of a car, could just as easily be the culprit. My father, Mark Miller, a former fire chief in the town of Cambria, on California's central coast, told me that he once responded to a wildfire touched off by, of all things, a hawk. The bird, he explained, had landed on high-voltage power lines, causing an electrical discharge. The flaming carcass hit the ground and lit the grass, he said. When it's that dry, almost anything can spark one of these fires. And once the fires get started, they are tremendously hard to stop. With these firestorms, you've literally got tens of millions of embers flying through the air. Chris Dykus, a professor of natural resources management and environmental sciences at California Polytechnic State University, San Luis Obispo, told me. These red-hot flecks aren't like the happy little embers from a fireplace, he said. They are being slapped against homes at 40 or 50 miles an hour, almost like a sideways rain. Any sort of nook or cranny that water might be able to get into, those embers will also get into and ignite the home. The reach and destructive power of these conflagrations were most evident in Santa Rosa, where fire spread rapidly from house to house, transforming entire neighborhoods into ashen wastelands littered with melted cars and standing chimneys. The catastrophe has been compounded by the fact that many homes in California, among some 2 million in the West, are situated in extremely fire-prone areas, right at the border between urban and wild. The state requires that residents maintain a defensible space around their houses, a 100-foot zone cleared of F.